Well, we're doing this series then, Graham, and thank you for coming back to Computerphile.
No problem.
About the most important thing in computing, or one of the most important things. Have you got something for us?
Yeah, I think so. So maybe it's not the most important, but it's certainly one of the most interesting and one of the weirdest ideas in computer science, and that is the Y-Combinator. The background to this is that in the last video, we did an introduction to the Lambda calculus, and this generated quite a lot of discussion and comments, which was very nice. And it turned out that the top comment was, can we have more on the Y-Combinator? So that's what we're going to do today. So what the Y-Combinator actually is a way of doing recursion in a language which doesn't have any recursion or any looping mechanism at all. So what we'll start off with is a quick refresher about what recursion actually is. So recursion is the idea of defining things in terms of themselves. And a simple example of this is the well-known factorial function. So let's have a little look at this. The way factorial works is you give it a number like 3, and it's going to count down from 3 to 1 and multiply up all the numbers in between. So for example, factorial of 3 then would be 3 times 2 times 1, which would give us the result 6. And then we can think, how do we actually define this function? And it turns out that the factorial function has a very simple and a very natural definition using recursion, defining things in terms of itself. So let's see how we can do that. If you give the factorial function a number n, it's going to make a choice between doing one of two things. If the number you give it is already 1, which is the point where you're trying to count down 2, then there's nothing to do. So if the number equals 1, then we just return the result 1. Otherwise, what we're going to do is we'll take the number you're given and we'll multiply it by the factorial of its predecessor. So for example, if n was 3, we would take 3 times the factorial of 2. So this is a recursive function because we're defining factorial in terms of itself. The factorial of any number n is defined in terms of the factorial of n minus 1. So you can see the way that this is going to work. If you give it a number like 3, it's going to loop around 2, 1, and so on until it eventually gets to 1, and then it will stop and do all the multiplies. So let's do a little example of this running to see that we know how it actually works. If we take factorial of 3, so factorial of any number that's not 1 is going to be that number times the factorial of its predecessor. So we'll take 3 times the factorial of 2. And then what do we do now? Well, we just do the same thing again. We've worked out what factorial of 3 is. Now we need to work out what factorial of 2 is, and we just run the definition again recursively. So we copy down what we had before. We have 3 times, and then we have 2 times factorial of 1. And then the final step is the base case. This is where the recursion stops because the factorial of 1, according to our definition, was just 1. So we're going to get 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. So that's a simple example of a recursive function and how it may run. So what we were looking at in the last video was the Lambda calculus, which is a minimal language for defining functions. And it's only got 3 things in it. It's got variables like x, y, and z. It's got a way of building functions. That's the Lambda notation that we saw last day. And it's got a way of applying functions. That's just putting 2 things next to each other. And everything else in the Lambda calculus is encoded in terms of these 3 basic things. So an example which we did last day was the logical values true and false. And I'll just refresh your memory about how we did this last day. The 2 logical values are true and false. And how do you represent these or encode these in the Lambda calculus? And you do it very simply as 2 functions. So true is going to be encoded as the function that takes 2 things, x and y, and just gives you back the first one, x. And then false is the opposite. It takes 2 things, x and y, and it gives you back the second one. And these encodings can then be used to define any other function which you'd like on the logical values. Like I think last day we looked at not, and we looked at and we looked at or. So any other function can be defined in terms of these 2 encodings. And these encodings are very natural. They express the idea that in programming, true and false are often used to choose between 2 different things. So if one thing is true, you do something, and if it's false, then you do something else. And these 2 definitions just encode this idea of choosing between one thing or another thing. What we're thinking about today is recursion. And you can ask yourself, if we have a definition like the factorial function here, the key thing in the definition is that it's recursive. We're defining the factorial function in terms of itself recursively. So how do we encode recursion in the lambda calculus, which doesn't have any sophisticated feature like that at all? So let's start off by reducing the problem a bit. Let me write down the very simplest recursive definition which I can think of. And the simplest possible recursive definition is just a program that loops. It doesn't do anything at all. So here would be the program. So I just say loop equals loop. And if you think about running this thing, you say, what's the value of loop, or how do you execute loop? Well, you just go to the right-hand side and you say, well, it's loop. So you go back to the left-hand side and it's just going to go around like this forever. It's just going to kind of spin on the spot without doing anything at all. So this is the simplest recursive program which you could write down. So how could I encode this behavior in the lambda calculus? And the key to this is something called self-application. It's the idea of applying something to itself, or in this case, applying a function to itself. So let me show you how to encode loop. So the way this works is we'll define loop to be this function here. So the first thing to observe is that we have two functions in here, and in fact, two copies of the same function. If you look at this function here, and this function here, they're both exactly the same. So what we're doing here is we're applying this function to itself. It's the idea of self-application. And this actually occurs at another level as well. If you look at what each of these functions actually does, it takes an input called x, and then it applies x to itself. So again, this is the idea of self-application. We're taking something in here, and then we're applying it to itself. And the same is happening over here. And it turns out that this idea of self-application is the key to how you do looping or recursion in a language which doesn't have support for that feature. So let's actually check that this thing actually has the behavior that we'd like. Check that it actually performs looping. If we write down the same thing again, we have lambda x, 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 and then we have lambda x, x, x. Let's think about how we can actually run this thing. So we need to remember what a function actually does. So a function takes an input, like x, and then it tells you what to do with it. So in this case, it takes an x and just makes two copies of it side by side. And in this case, the x is this thing here. This is the argument or the input to the function. We're applying it to itself. So what's going to happen is that this input is going to be plugged in or substituted for x, and then we'll just get two copies of the thing in the box. So that's how you would run the function. So if we write this down, we're going to get two copies of the box, and inside the box will be exactly the same thing. And what you see here is that in going from here to here, we've got exactly back to where we started. We started with this expression here, which was the definition of loop, and we've ended up with exactly the same thing. And of course, if we do the same thing again, if we say this is a function, this is its input, let's plug it in the two places where we see x, then we'll get exactly the same thing again. So this thing is just going to go around in circles. It will never get anywhere. Every time you run one step of it, it will go back to exactly the same point. So it encodes the idea of looping. So that's a simple example. Let's have a more general example of recursion. So here's a little recursive definition. I'm going to define a function called rec for recursion, and it's going to take another function as an input, and what it's going to do is apply that function to rec of f. So what does this definition actually do? Well, first of all, we can see that it's recursive because rec of f is defined in terms of rec of f, but it's not just looping around all the time. It's got a function f here sitting in the way. So if you think about unwinding this definition, what you'll get is f of f of f of f forever. If you run this recursive program, it's just going to apply the function f infinitely often. And this turns out to be the idea of what's called general recursion in computer science. This is the most general pattern of recursion you can have, and any other recursive function can be encoded in terms of this one. So if we can encode rec in the lambda calculus, we can encode any recursive function. But let me set you a couple of exercises at this point. Using the definition of rec, which is recursive, how do you program loop? Define or redefine loop to be rec of some function. So you've got to figure out what function to apply rec to here. And it's actually a very, very simple function. It's probably the simplest, or it is the simplest function you could write down in the lambda calculus. So don't try and overcomplicate it. Write down the simplest function you can here. Work through the definition of rec, and you'll see that it actually has the looping behavior. A slightly more interesting exercise, and a bit more challenging, is how to define the factorial function using rec. And I'll give you a bit of a hint on this one. What you need to do is pass it lambda f lambda n, and then you need to figure out what you write for the question mark here. Okay? And what you'll find is that the function that you write in here is not recursive. It's the non-recursive part of the factorial function. Okay? So that's a bit of a challenging exercise. This one's quite easy. This one's a little bit more challenging. But you'll learn a lot about the way recursion works in the lambda calculus if you do these two exercises. So what we've reached now is the point where if we can encode rec, which is general recursion, any other recursive function can be encoded in terms of that or defined in terms of that. If we can encode rec, then we're done because that lets us do everything. So it's a bit of a mouthful, so I haven't tried to memorize it. I've just got a copy pre-prepared here. Here is the definition, or one possible definition, of rec in the lambda calculus. And this is what's known as the Y-Combinator. And if you look at this, I mean, it looks like a jumble of symbols, but it's actually very similar to loop. If we look back to see the definition of loop, it had the idea of self-application. So we applied a function to itself, and the function we applied was lambda x, xx. And we saw how when you run that, it will actually achieve the looping behavior. If you look at the definition of the Y-Combinator, which is defined here, it's got exactly the same structure. Here we have a function, and here we have another copy of the same function. So it's exactly the same idea of self-application. The only difference here, we haven't got lambda x, xx. We've got an f in the way, and that's the f which is we're going to be kind of repeatedly applying when we do the recursion. So this is the Y-Combinator. It's not recursive, but it encodes recursion. And this is a very simple but powerful idea, and you can do this in most programming languages, unless you have some kind of type system which would stop you from doing this. This gives you a way of doing recursion in a language which doesn't have any recursion at all. If you want to know where it comes from, it was invented by a mathematician from the United States, Haskell Curry. And this is the Haskell who gives his name to the Haskell programming language. So if anyone asks you about the Y-Combinator, this is what it is. If you want to know a bit more about the Y-Combinator, you can, of course, look online. And there's a very nice Wikipedia page about this where you can find more details about these kind of things and see how to do some of the calculations and proofs of some of the things which I've been saying. But actually, it's interesting that the top hit on Google for Y-Combinator is not this stuff. It's actually a company which is called Y-Combinator. And you think, well, why would anyone call their company Y-Combinator? If you look at the company's webpage, they've got a frequently asked questions list. And one of the questions is, why did you choose the name Y-Combinator for your company? And they say a number of things here. So Y-Combinator is one of the coolest ideas in computer science. And of course, I'm going to agree with this. I think this is a very, very nice, very interesting fundamental idea about how you do recursion in a language which doesn't have recursion. And it's also a metaphor for what this company does. So the Y-Combinator is a way of having programs that run other programs. And in this case, it's a way of doing recursion in a language which doesn't have recursion. And that's basically what their company is doing. They're a company that helps start companies. They're a startup incubator in Silicon Valley. And it's the same kind of self-application idea. They want to help someone to make a company. And it's the same thing here. We want to have programs that run other programs. So for me, this is certainly one of the coolest ideas in computer science. This is Alonzo Church, who was a mathematician at Princeton University in the United States. And he was the person who invented the lambda calculus. And what he was interested in is what is the notion of a function